I just briefly want to say, before we bring on our final panel, why I love journalism. And oddly enough, I'll frame it in terms of the 2016 election. So during the 2016 election season, I was teaching for a while at New York University, where I had been a visiting professor for 4 years, and then also writing for 538. And I did a series on American demographics. And so I met with white evangelical Christians in the South. I met with Mexican American voters in Arizona. I met with Trump voters in Warren, Ohio. I met with, you know, black millennial voters, any number of different demographics. And one of the things that I think that we have to remember is that for many journalists of color, what we want is the freedom not just to cover our own communities, which I certainly have done, but to cover everyone, to be treated like any other journalist and given the chance. And after the election, I decided to go to Harvard, but in between I went to Standing Rock with a team of radio reporters out of Montana, and I was there for the Veterans Weekend, and I was there for literally 6 days, during which time there was a blizzard, you know, and hundreds or maybe even a couple thousand veterans showed up, and I just thought about the people who came and stayed there for months on end in these conditions. I ended up getting trench foot, which is something where the bottom of your feet go numb. It lasted 3 months because I wasn't an experienced outdoors person and I didn't take proper care of myself. But that is that whether you were a water protector or whether you were a journalist, you were facing the same elements. And so in the end, that was an incredibly positive experience for me because I got to see another side of America. And I myself am still learning about Native American cultures, of which there are, you know, obviously thousands, and how to report on them. But I want to say that there is such love in me for the practice of journalism because at its best, it brings us closer to ourselves and closer to each other. It is not just gloom and doom. And so our final panel, and I would like to welcome the panelists on whenever they're ready, is going to be about the future of journalism and our ability to shape that future. And so with us coming up on stage, we have Martina Guzmán, who is with, she's the board chair of Feet in Two Worlds, also does independent radio reporting and producing, and is also at Wayne State University. Ed Lewis, who is the founder of Essence Magazine and a serial entrepreneur and someone who's always on point, and John Funabiki, formerly of the Ford Foundation, now runs Renaissance Journalism. So thank you all for being with us. And I want to just thank Darren and all of the Ford team, the OC, CFE. We have a lot of acronyms, but without them, this would not be possible. So as I said, you know, journalism for me, it's, you know, no question it's a struggle, but there's that whole statement, the joy is in the struggle. You know, that's where you find meaning, you find purpose. And Ed, you had an idea, a vision of creating media targeted at black women. And I want to start out with a round of success, triumph over preconceptions and adversity. So tell us how you were able to overcome the perception that this was not a viable commercial product and that you, therefore, you shouldn't have enough money to really launch it well.
In 2005, I was having a private dinner with the then Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice. And she asked me, she said, Ed, how did you get involved in starting a magazine for black women? And I said to her, before I tell you that, you and I are on the opposite end of the political spectrum. Having said that, you are the Secretary of State, a black woman. Mm-hmm. When Essence came into being in 1970, black women were thought of as uncouth, loudmouth, unfeminine, poor, on welfare. And here you are, the Secretary of State. Mm-hmm. And what's happened during that 48 years now, for me, I'm celebrating the idea of Essence was conceived in 1968. Essence is 48 years old. And it came into being because four black men had an idea to want to celebrate the beauty, the intelligence of black women, because the other women's magazines, like glamour or Harper's Bazaar or good housekeeping. We're not dealing with the aspirations and beauty of black women. So that gave us our niche, our opportunity to come in to try to tell this story about what's going on with black women, and certainly what we see now in terms of Black Panther.
Yeah.
I hope everyone has seen Black Panther. Yeah. But more importantly, those incredibly black women.
Yeah.
Warriors.
Yeah.
And I just think it speaks volumes about what Essence has done to, I think, to change the dynamics in terms of how black women are thought of. But back then, in 1968, you had four black men, no experience in publishing, who tried to do something in terms of trying to raise money. We put a business plan together of $1,500,000, but we only opened our doors with $130,000. So we were severely undercapitalized. But I sometimes believe that if I had had $1,500,000 up front, I may not be talking to you now. It's amazing what you can do with less.
Yeah. So you found a way out of no way to do more with less. All right. Well, you know, Martina, you wear a number of different hats in the media landscape, and part of your work is in public radio. And public radio, despite being public, and I think to be just very frank and not at all pandering, WDET is much more diverse than most cities' public radio stations. But in many cities, there is a color line in public media where you would expect there to be a sense of a greater public, but it's vastly underrepresented in many cities in public radio. Tell us what you do to deal with what is sometimes a color line in public media, not just here in Detroit, but your work also that helps foster other people's careers.
Well, I do a couple of things. I'm board chair of Feet Into Worlds, which is an organization that brings together ethnic immigrant journalists of color from across the country, and we nurture and mentor them. We aggressively sort of find them and bring them together, and then do the same thing, aggressively support their work. And once they create a body of work, then we connect them with a news organization and use our clout to get them recognized and to get their work either in a newspaper, in print, or on the radio. And it also creates a sort of a network in between the fellows themselves. Journalists of color feel isolated when they're in newsrooms, when they're the only person of color. And I think this is true throughout the industry. When you're the only person representing sort of every minority or every ethnic community, it's difficult, it's challenging, and it's hard. And when you feel like your voice isn't being heard, the experience can be daunting. And what we aim to do at Feet Into Worlds is to bring this collective community together so that they don't have that feeling that maybe they're not getting the support at the radio station or at the newspaper that they may be working at, but they get it from each other. And I think that's a critical component.
Yeah.
You know, I think they need that support. They need to be able to connect with one another, to trade information, to here's the email to an editor, or let me introduce you to this person. And then they become a community that supports one another.
Yeah, that cohort building. Thank you. And John, you're also doing work at expanding the lens. When we talked about race during the Kerner era, it was framed in terms of black and white, even though obviously there were other people in America.
There was me.
Yeah, exactly. But I think that, you know, it's you know, I myself, as a child, moved from the Upper West Side of New York to Baltimore from essentially a multiracial frame on race to back to a city where my mom had grown up, where the frame was still very black and white, but also the demographics were. So both our demographics have changed, but also we just have opened up to the idea like, wow, actually, we're not just, you know, an either or. And how does your work at Renaissance Journalism explore that, expand that?
Yeah, well, thank you very much for having me here, and thanks to Ed and Martina for their work. I think they show the passion that we all have for this kind of work. And maybe I should start just by saying that, everything that Kerner says is very, very personal to me, because I grew up in a predominantly black neighborhood after World War II, because that's where my parents, Japanese Americans, could buy a house after they came out of the internment camps, right? It was a very multicultural neighborhood, predominantly African-American, but also Latino, Asian-American.
Which neighborhood?
East Palo Alto, California.
Oh,
East
wow.
Do you know it?
Oh, boy.
So we grew up with a multicultural lens, right? And the riots of the 60s, the rebellions of the 60s, we feared that that might happen in our neighborhood, but it did not. And one reason it did not happen is because we, as kids, we all played together, right? And there were self-organized cool it squads that went around the streets and said, hey, if there's trouble, let's try to calm things down. Getting back to your point, though, or question, one of the things I found really helpful is to... One of the things that we found very helpful to do at Renaissance Journalism is to work with collaborations of journalists. So involving ethnic media journalists, and here in Detroit, there are great examples of ethnic media who really know their communities, and we connect them to mainstream journalism outfits so that they can work together and try to figure out how to cover a story differently. The other thing we try to do is get journalists to reframe the way they define the story. And what we do is ask them to use the lens of equity and social justice. So whatever story you're working on, whatever the issue is, what are the equity questions that should be asked? And that will lead you to diversity and inclusion.
Yeah, I mean, it's the equity lens is really one that we have to pay attention to when we talk about Kerner, because the Kerner Commission report didn't just say, it did talk about the tokenism of the employment of the rare African-American in the newsroom, but it talked about the legitimate expectation of citizens for adequate representation in the media and how for African-Americans, that legitimate expectation was not at all met. So what does that mean to you? I'm gonna go to you first, Martina. What does it mean? Do you resonate with this idea that it's legitimate to have an expectation of adequate representation in the media? And maybe how does media fit into the broader picture of democracy?
Well, journalism is completely connected to democracy. One, and to your point about racial equity, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, if you're not talking about racial equity, if you're not reporting in communities, if you're not reporting on injustices, you're not doing your job. I mean, these... while I'm the board chair at Feet into Worlds, I'm also the Race and Justice Journalism Fellow at the Damon J. Keith Center for Civil Rights, and everything we do there is through a racial equity lens. That's where, when you look at it through that frame, that's where everything important is happening. That's where democracy is happening. If you're looking into communities, you know, where there's a lack of transportation, this is a community of people who are sort of chasing the American dream against all the odds. They're chasing it without the ability to have proper transportation. They're chasing the American dream while their schools are being closed. They're chasing the American dream, you know, while they don't have access to proper food or to proper health care. And if you're not reporting on that, if you're not in that, in the mix every day, all the time, then I'm not really sure what you're reporting on. And, you know, I am lucky enough to have at the Keats Center incredible support to be able to report on these issues. And I think what one of the solutions to it is to create, you know, a small army of people who are doing this. Mm-hmm. There has to be a paradigm shift. We have to really radically shift how we change our focus, you know, on what we report on, especially in cities like Detroit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If I may add too, I honestly believe with Trump being in the White House, that people of color should have no illusions about where they stand. They should understand that there are a large number of people who don't like us. Doesn't matter whether we went to Harvard, University of Chicago, how rich we are. And so it is incumbent upon us to work together to make sure that we have our interests be assessed and dealt with within a society. In that vein, the other thing that I feel very good about, I also co-founded a magazine for Hispanic women called Latina. The founder of Latina.
That's right.
The founder of Latina was a young lady by the name of Christy Halberger, who came to my office in 1995, and she began to tell me about this idea about a bilingual magazine for Hispanic women. And the first thing I said to her, I said, Christy, your last name, Halberger, does not suggest that you're Hispanic. But what happened, she was born, she was adopted when she was 1 year old by a German family in Houston, Texas. They had the sensitivity to inculcate this young lady with her heritage. She went to the University of Texas and she went to Stanford Law School. And she began to remind me of myself when I started Essence, mm-hmm. and how Hispanic women were viewed within the marketplace. And I saw then, or realized that the potential growth and opportunity in this market was there. I also thought if Essence, I had a magazine for black women, and I could also develop a magazine for Hispanic women, together we'd be an incredible marketing power. But also, it was about blacks and Hispanics working together.
Yeah.
Because in the end, we help build this country, and we as Americans need to make sure that we get all the goodies that this country affords us in terms of who we are.
I want to stay with you for a second, Ed, because you mentioned, you know, the business opportunities of Essence. And can you show the cover? Some very delicious human beings from Black Panther. You know. But you mentioned how there is a, you know, we can support each other, and there's money in communities of color to support publications. And I want to reference some research that we talked about earlier today. McKinsey research on diversity. Companies in the top quartile of racial diversity in terms of their leadership are 35% more likely to have above median returns for their industry. So basically there's a 35% bump up if you have diverse, racially diverse leadership, 15% for gender diverse leadership. And yet, and still, in the media, often, diversity is just poor mouthed. It's like, oh, well, we can't spend money on that. It's like, well, if there's a proven model that diverse leadership produces higher returns, do business arguments matter in an era where, you know, we have the data, but we don't seem, I mean, I have seen enough startups, media startups, and the media startup money rarely goes to women or people of color. So how do we process that?
We have to continuously make an effort to tell our story, to make sure to have corporations and marketers understand the power of the consumer, mm-hmm. blacks, Hispanics, Asians, and we need to develop coalitions. We need to tap in. There's a great deal of money that's around today with regard to private equity, the Small Business Administration. Banks make opportunities, loans for people to be able to start their own businesses. So there's opportunity there.
Yeah.
Farai, can I jump
yes,
in on
please.
That? I think there's also the argument or the reality that by better serving all these different diverse communities, that we can improve the trust in media. And that's
yes.
a huge issue right now. And you can look at all kinds of studies. Let's go back to the ethnic media example. That the audiences or the subscribers, viewers, whatever it's newspaper, television, radio, they're very loyal to their media outlets, mm-hmm. And that can transcend generations. So even if it's a Spanish language newspaper, even in the second generation or the third generation, the studies show that the children and the grandchildren still rely to a certain extent. On the newspapers that they were introduced to by their parents or their grandparents, because those news outlets really resonate with them.
Yeah.
And they're accustomed to the way they cover the story, and that those news organizations understand the culture and the history of those communities. And that disconnect exists with the mainstream media. And so by incorporating those audiences and those journalists into the news outlets, I think we can improve this trust question that we have.
Yeah. You know, I'm just wondering, any of you can answer this. To me, the Kerner frame also fits white Americans who are not often represented. Rural people of color aren't represented either, but, you know, rural white Americans and working income and low-income white Americans. And one of the things that I have done over the past 15, 16 months is correspond with a guy who's a member of the alt-right white nationalist movement. And I've done reporting on white supremacist and white nationalist throughout my career. What I found was that my knowledge about white nationalism was not particularly respected in the newsroom during the 2016 election, I think because people assumed I was black and paranoid, instead of someone who had actually been in the field, met Klans people during a blizzard, stormed into a white supremacist church in the middle of the Deep South during worship so I could interview a pastor who threatened to dig up the body of a mixed race infant because it didn't belong in a white cemetery. And I bring all this up because it strikes me that you're talking about integrating the experiences of people of color. Do we also need to integrate the experience? I don't see a lot of working class white people in major newsrooms. I don't see a lot of poor white people in major newsrooms. Is that also something that we as people and as journalists need to be concerned about?
Well, I think we need to get better connected really at an intimate level with the people who live in our communities. One experiment we've been trying in the San Francisco Bay Area is we've been asking journalists, news organizations, to host small, intimate dinner conversations with people in the community, just plain folk, and just talk. And you'd be surprised the different kind of a conversation that comes, mm-hmm. that happens when you're breaking bread and chatting,
yes.
rather than interviewing and sticking a mic in somebody's face. It really does change the journalist's understanding of what people are concerned about.
Yeah, and I didn't mean to imply that like all lower income white people are white nationalists or supremacists. First of all, the guy I've been corresponding with is not low income. And secondly, a lot of the reporting that I found white people who pushed back against these white nationalist narratives, and no one listened to them either. So, I mean, that's somewhat disturbing. But what, kind of more on point with what you were saying, when I went into areas where I knew that as a black woman with dreadlocks, people might find me discomforting, I would just embed myself in a coffee shop, buy a lot of pie and coffee, and you know, take time to talk about people's grandkids and their work histories. But that takes time, and time is money, and newsroom managers don't always want to pay for the time it takes to do that. So Martina, first, and then Ed, how do you deal with the time is money equation, and then a kind of cross-cutting, you know, it takes time to warm people up to journalist conversation?
Well, first of all, I just don't buy that argument, you know, because there are people that are spending thousands of dollars, like, on podcasts.
Yes.
Thousands. WNYC, to produce a podcast in New York, is $25,000 per one episode. And they're spending that kind of money, but then at the same time paying freelancers $200 or saying we can't make that higher. It's like it's a priority, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If covering communities of color, having a diverse newsroom, making sure that upper management is represented in class diversity, in ethnic diversity, that's a core value. And if you don't have that core value, then you're probably making crappy news. And you know, and, you know, John, you were saying this on our phone call this week, and I couldn't agree with you more, is that the reason people stop buying news and reading news is because they were making bad news. I mean, they want to blame it on the model. They want to blame it on how the internet changed. Well, if you weren't prepared for that, and if you didn't have the foresight to see that, that's one, that's an indicator of like who's managing you, one. And then two, you've lost communities of color because you don't represent them. Like, but don't blame it on them and you know, and say like it's a money issue. No, it isn't. You know, your core values are off.
Yeah.
And it needs to be said over and over and over again.
Yeah. And Ed, you know, Essence is a lifestyle magazine, but it has over the years done hard news and, you know, won awards for stories about HIV in African American women, any number of stories. How did you think about, you know, in your time at Essence, how did you think about the idea of integrating hard news into the lifestyle publication?
We wanted black women not to be taken for granted. We wanted our audience to understand that things were happening internationally. We covered apartheid, for example, in South Africa long before anyone was even talking about it. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I treasure about being born in New York, I got a football scholarship to the University of New Mexico. The only thing I knew about New Mexico then was that the atomic bomb was built in Los Alamos and exploded in Alamogordo. But coming from New York to New Mexico was a cultural shock. Right. 8,000 students, five blacks and one black woman.
Wow.
I was forced to integrate to the larger community, Anglo-Americans, Hispanics, and then Native Americans. And that was very helpful to understand this is a huge country.
Yes.
People are
yes.
very different.
Yes.
And so we have got to understand and get ourselves involved in these communities in order to be able to do our jobs in terms of being good journalists.
Absolutely. You know, one thing I want to just flag is that tomorrow the Women's Media Center is releasing its first ever status of women of color in the U.S. news media. And that's a subset of their annual survey on women in the media. So I'm looking forward to that. So pay attention to that. But as we wrap up, you know, I have heard passion and fire and some frustration, but not a shred of giving up. Not a shred of giving up on the role of the media in society. So what is it that we can bring? And I'm just going to, you know, go straight down the line, starting with you, Ed. What is it that we can bring to the table as people who have practiced media and who care about media to the future of this country, not just to media as a practice, because the whole point is to do something bigger. So what is it that we can do moving forward?
As once a trustee of Tuskegee University, and one of the oldest trustees, he was 85 years old, we had a break in our meeting, and as we were talking, I was asking, what is it about us as black people been able to overcome all the oppression, lynchings that has happened to us? And he looked at me, he was 6 feet eight. He looked at me, he said, young man, the best explanation I can give you is that we just refuse to die.
Ah, that's right, that's
we
right.
We refuse to die. And so it's incumbent to understand the importance of the press, because it is a fourth media. It's important for us to have some control over the narrative, and to that degree that if we can have that kind of control, we can tell our story. And that's really what's going on here. Essence is 48 years old because it's connected with black women. If it had not connected editorially with black women, we wouldn't be talking about having a magazine that continuously reports on what's going on. So it's about content, it's connection, commitment, and just staying true. We've all been here before. We got to stay here longer to overcome and just keep working at it.
Thank you. Ed Lewis, co-founder of Essence. And Martina?
You know, one of the things that I've really learned from being at the Damon Keith Center for Civil Rights and this, you know, collective of extraordinary activists that not only, you know, are telling their own story, but are in the fight, in the trenches every day. And I had a conversation with someone, a highly respected activist, Monica Lewis Patrick, known as one of the Water Warriors. And I think she saw one time, you know, how daunted I was by the lack of an ability that I felt like I wasn't making a difference. And she said, baby, no. Mm-hmm. She said, this is a multi-generational fight.
That's right.
You know? She says, we fight and we pass the torch on to the next generation. And that radically changed my view.
Yeah.
You know, because I felt like I had to see transformation right now, that I had to see, you know, this wall come down mm-hmm. and that I was somehow part of it. And somehow maybe I am part of it, but it doesn't mean it's gonna happen right now. But, you know, you just got to keep chipping away at that wall. And, you know, the women of Detroit have really helped me see that.
Thank you. And John, I had forgotten until you had mentioned it before, but that your family had been in the internment camps of American citizens of Japanese descent. And I always think about the Korematsu case, which was the Supreme Court case that said, well, yes, this was legal. And as many people have pointed out, what's legal is not always right. Mm-hmm. That we did it, and then we actually, at the Supreme Court level, justified it. How do you keep going? What is your rationale, and how do you see the future?
So let me say two things. One is, just like everybody else, I'm very frustrated. But for those of us who are working in the media, I actually am an optimist, because I think this is actually the most exciting time to be in the media, because there's a lot of experimentation. A lot of the old rules have started to fall aside because journalists and other media makers realize it's not working very well,
Yeah. And
we've got to try some new things. And so that's where I want to place my bets. That's where I want to play, if you will. From the community side, where I'm also frustrated, I say we got to screen more. Mm-hmm. I think that we've got to apply more pressure on the media organizations to make them change.
Thank you so much. So Ed Lewis, Martina Guzmán, and John Funabiki. Thank you. And we're going to hear next from Kevin Ryan at Ford. Thank you.